Salam alaikum, bonjour. J'entame cette série de vidéos intitulée Demande au Shir pour vous emmener au cœur de l'islam, au cœur de la croyance musulmane. Alors, pourquoi Demande au Shir? Eh bien, comme vous, j'ai beaucoup de questions relatives à l'islam. Et en tant que musulman, quand on a une question, on va voir un théologien, on va voir un imam, on va voir quelqu'un de science. Et une personne de science, une personne qui a la sagesse en islam, ça s'appelle un shir. C'est pour ça que lors de mon tour du monde musulman, et lorsque j'aurai des questions relatives à la religion, je poserai la question à un shir. Aujourd'hui, j'ai rencontré un shir qui s'appelle Ismaël, il est anglais, il a étudié la religion à l'université de Médine en Arabie Saoudite, et il travaille pour le gouvernement de Dubaï ici, pour présenter l'islam aux non-musulmans et pour présenter l'islam aux touristes. Alors, je lui ai posé une question toute simple, mais vous allez voir, essentielle. L'interview se passe en anglais. Pour avoir les sous-titres en français ou dans une autre langue, vous cliquez sur CC dans YouTube. Je vous dis à tout à l'heure.
Cheikh Ismaël, what is the most important thing in Islam?
Okay. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع سنته إلى يوم الدين. Praise be to Allah, the one and only God, true God worthy of worship, and I send peace and blessings upon his final prophet, the Prophet Muhammad, and upon the Prophet Muhammad's family, companions, and all those who follow the guidance until the last day. What is the most important thing in Islam? Well, before I answer that, I'd like to touch upon for many of the viewers out there, what is Islam? Because Islam is something that is misconceived, and there are a lot of misconceptions, and a lot of people don't actually realize what the word Islam means. Now, the word Islam actually means to submit. To submit. But obviously, what are we talking about here? We're talking about submitting to the will, to the orders, to the commands of Almighty God, Allah. That is what Islam means. Islam has no strange hidden meaning behind it. And we see many places in the Quran where, for example, the story of Abraham, when God Almighty Allah says to him, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. When God Almighty Allah said to the Prophet Abraham, submit, and he replied, I have submitted to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. So that is what Islam actually means. And then the person who follows Islam and submits themselves then becomes a Muslim. So they are attaching themselves to Islam. Just like you have the word walk. When you walk, you are a walker. Or talk, talker. Speak, speaker. So Islam, the person who practices this submission to the one and almighty God, he then becomes a Muslim. So that's the definition, firstly, of what Islam means. Now going on from that, the most important belief in Islam, and it's the first pillar of Islam. Islam is based upon five pillars, which you can call the foundations. Just like this room or this building has pillars, foundations. Without these foundations, the building would collapse and it would no longer be a proper, intact building. So likewise, a person's faith has pillars, foundations, that they must be there at the very least for the person to be considered to be a Muslim. And the first one of these pillars, there are five, I won't go into describe all of them, but briefly, the first one is to testify that there is no true God worthy of worship except Allah, and that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last and final messenger of a long line of messengers. This is what we call in Islam Tawheed. Now Tawheed actually means to make something one. It comes from the Arabic root word of Wahada, which means to make something one. Now we're obviously here talking about the oneness of Almighty God. And that is the pinnacle of Islam. The most important belief of Islam is that God, Almighty God, is one. And this is what is called Tawheed. Now Tawheed is not simply believing that there is one God, because many people say that I believe there's one God, but they turn their worship and their prayer to idols or statues or holy men or even dead people in the grave. So that is an aspect, but there, Islam splits this oneness of God into three different categories. The first one is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, which means the oneness of Almighty God in His Lordship, meaning that he is the only one who creates us, who sustains us, who protects us, who maintains and keeps everything in order. And then there is Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, which means the oneness of God Almighty in his worship, and we should only worship him, and he is the only one who deserves to be worshipped, and he is the only one who can answer our prayers, and he is the only one who can harm or benefit us. And the third category is Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat, which is the oneness of God Almighty in his names and attributes, meaning he is only the all-powerful, or the all-merciful, or the all-kind, and nobody else can be the all-powerful, or the all. All of us can be kind, or powerful, or merciful, but we can never be the all-merciful, or the all-powerful. And his attributes, such as I mentioned briefly before, that he is the creator, and he is the one who knows the unseen, and he is the one who benefits and harms us. So these are the categories that Islam describes the oneness of Almighty God. And going on from that, we, or Muslims, believe that this is the essential message that all of the prophets came with. We don't believe that the prophets came with different messages. We say that from the time of Adam, through all of the prophets, from Noah up into Abraham, Moses, Jesus, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them all, they all came with exactly the same message, which was to worship God alone. And we do not believe that all of a sudden with Jesus that this message changed and became where God became three, or God had partners. We say that this was always the message. And furthermore, in the Quran there is a chapter which the Islamic scholars have called that this is the mother of this Tawheed, this oneness of Allah, meaning it's a summary, and it's a beautiful summary, and a very brief but at the same time very concise and comprehensive, and explains a lot in this short chapter or surah. And this is called Surah Al-Ikhlas, which you can translate as the chapter of sincerity. And the God Almighty says in this chapter, he says, "Qul huwa Allahu ahad." Say that he is Allah the One, Allahu samad, that he is the eternal, the absolute. Lam yalid, he does not beget, he does not have children. Wa lam yulad, nor was he begotten, nor was he born himself. Wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad, and that nothing is like him. So we can see from the first verse that say Allah, he is one. It's establishing to us that Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, is one. And then it's saying that he is the eternal, the absolute. So he does not die, and he is eternal. And that brings into us another aspect of how we describe God Almighty, that he cannot be someone who dies, or someone who gets weak, or someone who sleeps and get tired and have these kind of human characteristics. And then it goes on to say that he does not beget, again, he does not have the human characteristic of having children. He is God, and for him to be God, he can be nothing like us. And then he himself obviously was not begotten, otherwise again he cannot be God if he was born. And then it goes on beautifully to end by saying that there is nothing like him, nothing like him. No matter how much you tried to think of something beautiful and majestic and superb in your mind, you can never come close to imagining the greatness of Allah, of God Almighty, because we can never, there is nothing comparable to him, nothing on this earth, nothing we can see, nothing we've smelt, nothing we've even seen with our eyes that can even compare to being anything like him. And if we look into this unique belief of Islam, why do I say unique? Because you'll find that this belief, to this detail and to this exact oneness of Almighty God, is unique to Islam. And we look at other religions, for example Christianity or Judaism, me coming from a Christian background, and we see that the concept of there being the one God is there, the Rububiyyah, that he is the ultimate God, he is the creator. But we see that in the other aspects of worship, of giving characteristics and attributes and names that are only befitting for God alone, are giving to other people. And we hear stories again that give God this, make God ungodly. For example, we hear stories in the Bible where God is creating the heavens and the earth in 6 days and then resting. and we see examples of God walking through the Garden of Eden looking for Adam. And we're talking about God who created the heavens and the earth. However, he is supposed to be walking in the Garden of Eden and he can't find Adam. So how can we say this? This is the Almighty Creator, but he cannot find one of his creation. And we hear stories of God wrestling with Jacob and Jacob overpowering God. And we hear stories of God regretting that he created man and repenting. And we say, who was God, the Almighty, the only one, the only Creator? Who was he repenting to? We repent to God. Who was God repenting to? So we look into this and we see that Islam is very unique in its emphasis on God must be one in all of these aspects, and he cannot be in any way compared to human or given humanistic or animalistic characteristics. And we look at other religions. For example, we see in the Hinduism, in the Hindu religion, Hinduism, that many of the concepts are taken from ancient stories of Indian kings and princes and warriors who then were raised after their death, and stories were written down and bits were added here and there, and they became elevated to the status of gods. And that's why we have very strange stories of gods having sexual relations with other gods, and gods having little baby gods, and this god getting jealous of the other god's wife because she's more beautiful or more sexually attractive, and lots of strange things. And we see maybe 365 or so idols being worshipped. And then we hear stories, we look at the, for example, Buddhism. Now Buddhism is also a very popular religion here. We see many people in the West, we see many Hollywood actors and stars, they like Buddhism. They say Buddhism gives this human rights and animal rights. And funny enough, you'll find all of this in Islam and more. And what we find is that Buddha himself taught that there is no God. According to the teachings that we have received from Buddha, they say that he taught there was no God. Yet the people take Buddha as a God, and they follow a scripture that was written 400 or so, hundreds of years later, by monks. So I was watching a video yesterday on YouTube, and I think the title was something like French Muslims on the Bus or something like that. And I was actually really surprised, because when I looked at this video, there is a bunch of French Muslims and they are on a very busy bus. Obviously there are French non-Muslims there, and they are there, okay, it's in Arabic, but they're shouting, you know, different supplications, we call them dua, different prayers, talking about Israel and this, and they're shouting Allahu Akbar, very loud voice. And what I noticed, there was one particular man, he was doing all of the shouting and the other ones were saying Ameen, like Amen, agreeing to his prayer. And this particular guy was right next to a woman, a French non-Muslim woman, and he's actually putting his hand next to his mouth to give the loud effect. And he's shouting right next to her, Allahu Akbar! And I said to myself, what are these guys doing? Do they think that they are serving the cause of Islam? Do they not think that they are just doing what the non-Muslims think about Muslims? That these guys are aggressive people, they're shouting, they're violent. Do you think those French people thought, oh, I'm really scared now, let me go home and look into Islam, because they scared me so much, I will read the Quran? Or did they go home and did they say, look at these guys shouting at us, these guys really are terrorists, these guys really are crazy, these guys really hate us, these guys are really, you know, aggressive and barbaric, just like in those cartoons that they're drawing in the magazine? Why didn't these guys say to themselves, maybe these guys were angry, maybe they saw a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and this upset them? But we see the Prophet Muhammad himself, when he was being beaten and insulted, he didn't get upset with the people. So who are we now to come and say, I'm going to go and find a non-Muslim on the street and beat him, I'm going to see a guy come out of a synagogue, a Jewish man, and I'm going to punch him or stab him or abuse him because of what the non-Muslims are doing, when the Prophet Muhammad didn't even do that to the people who were actually beating him? He called them to Islam, he tried to teach them. So why did these guys go onto the bus in a big group with all the other non-Muslims there, and why did they not give out a small leaflet in French about the reality of the Prophet Muhammad or the reality of Islam and the Prophet Muhammad's, peace be upon him's message? Why did they not go up to them, and I can't speak French, but why did they go up to them and say, bonjour, ça va, and start speaking to them and telling them, do you know this guy, he wrote about the Prophet Muhammad? I just want to tell you something. Instead of them, they're already forcing themselves upon the crowd. They don't have to ask permission. They're already shouting their heads off, forcing everyone to listen to them. No one understands what they're talking about. Why not do the same thing? Why not stand there and say, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to tell you about the reality of the Prophet Muhammad, and that he wasn't this and he wasn't that, and give them examples of where he was merciful and kind, where he could have taken revenge, and he had the power to kill lots of people, but he didn't. He said to them, I forgive you, I pray that you become Muslims. Why didn't they do that? They are only making the image of Islam worse. So I call all of the Muslims out there that no matter how bad things happen, do it in the way of the Prophet Muhammad. Go to them and call them to Islam. Who told you can go and attack French, attack embassies, or burn flags, or attack people? Who says you can do this? Where are you getting this from? Or is this just you using your emotions? Or are you being just as bad as them?
So pray.
Yes, time to pray.
Voilà, j'espère que la vidéo a été enrichissante pour vous. En tout cas, pour moi, elle l'a été. Alors, après chaque vidéo de la série, j'ai envie de vous donner un conseil de lecture. Là, c'est le plus important. Le Coran. Le Coran, traduction en langue française. Alors, je vous ai laissé le lien dans la description YouTube pour l'acheter sur Amazon. Si jamais vous voulez pas passer par Amazon ou par une librairie, vous pouvez l'avoir gratuitement. Le bon plan, je vous le donne. Vous envoyez une lettre à l'ambassade d'Arabie Saoudite en France, vous cherchez dans Google l'adresse et vous demandez une traduction en français et ils vous en enverront un. C'est le plan low cost. Voilà. Allez sur le site muslimworldtour.com, inscrivez-vous à la newsletter, partagez la page Facebook sur votre profil, faites tourner les vidéos, faites tourner les photos, faites tourner les articles. Et je vous dis à très bientôt. Salam alaikum.